So thank you again for coming to our seminar, which is the second in a row devoted to a debate about how to finance infrastructure in Europe. I wouldn't say at European level, because I want us to look into various possibilities of financing, either at the national, European level, from public or private money. We had already a seminar devoted to this issue, in which we learned from people representing the decision or the policy makers at European level. And we heard their views. We thought we need to learn more from the stakeholders to see what are the views about the needs of infrastructure and also the need of the money to finance this infrastructure. Myself as a liberal, of course, I'm thinking that the market should be the first option or first driving force for financing infrastructures. And what I fear and I focus is to make sure that us in Brussels are not, we are not worsening things by taking decisions which would affect the market or which would not help the private investment to come in an era in which we absolutely need it. Our first panel today is devoted to talking about financing infrastructure and transport, and already traditionally, I'm sharing this with my colleague, Mrs. Meissner, and I stop here and I give the floor to her to introduce our honored guests in the panel today.
Yeah, thank you, Adina. Yes, as you heard it already, we are starting with transport. I am Gesine Meissner. I'm the coordinator of the Liberals of the ALDE Group and the Transport Committee. And well, of course, what we found out as soon as we started debating transport issues in this period, we found out that the money wasn't enough. And when Commissioner Kallas started being a commissioner for transport here in the European Parliament, he at first had the idea of creating a transport fund, because he knew, as a finance expert, it's a lot of things to do, because transport infrastructure is extremely necessary for the internal market, and the money is not there. And so he started already to think about how to do it. And then since the Parliament didn't agree as a whole that there should be a special transport fund, we thought about other solutions. He had very good talks already with Commissioner Hahn, who's responsible for the budget for the region and for cohesion funds. But of course, it's a still ongoing discussion, because some money could be dedicated to transport out of this special fund. But as well, we have to think about what can the member states finance, what about public-private partnership and everything else. And so now, this time today, Adina announced it already, we have stakeholders here, because they, of course, have their special point of view. Not only the Commission has something to say, of course, the stakeholders are very important players in this field, and that's why we invited stakeholders today. And I can have the honor to, I have the honor to introduce you to Slavimir Kazimierczak. I hope it's the right pronunciation, yeah?
To my left. Is quite good.
Okay, and then it's Mark Smeets and Richard Abel. That's the first panel. And we start with Slavomir Kaczmierczak. He is a deputy director of Investment Planning and Monitoring Bureau and head office in Poland of his party, of his group. And he graduated in Łódź. Is this Łódź or Watch? Watch. And in the Faculty for Economic Cybernetics and Computer Science. He is the deputy director at the present of Investment Planning and Monitoring Bureau. And he is involved and responsible for the preparation of railway projects co-financed by the European Union. And in the past, he worked for road construction companies, for road administration, and as a director of EU Funds Bureau. And so that really shows that he is and was for a long time already involved in infrastructure problems and in thinking about financing of infrastructure. And so I would like to give him... yes, Kathy, please. I would like to give him immediately the floor, and I will introduce the other speakers afterwards, shortly before they just make their part. But please now, Mr. Kazimierczak, you can take the floor, please.
Thanks a lot for the invitation. I would like to present some problems which we have met during the implementation of Polish railway projects. Especially, I would like to show you the present state of our railway network. It's very, I think, interesting for us because, as you can see, only 36% of the infrastructure in Poland is in good condition. The 35% is in satisfactory condition, and nearly 30% is in unsatisfactory condition. And this is some information about the maximum speed which our trains can reach in Poland. Only 5.6% lines are adjusted to the speed of 160 kilometers per hour, and 14.2% are adjusted to the speed between 120 and 160. It means that about 20% of the lines are adjusted to the speed between 120, 160, and about 80% of the infrastructures is under this condition, under this range. And this is the state, the length of lines in operation in Poland. As you can see, in comparison to the 1990, about 20% of the lines we should withdraw with the operation because of the bad condition of the lines. So there are tasks for us, for the Polish railways. First of all, to increase speed passenger trains, to improve the competitiveness with the road transport and air transport, and to creation the priority network for economically effective and fast freight transport, and to achieve maximum interoperability of Polish railways with the European network and increase the rail traffic safety. The third task is very, very challenging for us because it can be achieved by implementation of ERTMS. This is a European system to manage the railway trains. And that's our goals you would like to implement in this financial period and the future, the next period, 2014-2020. First of all, we would like to modernize generally up to 160 kilometers per hour the main lines of TNT network. The second task is to renew the revitalization of lines to the parameters which were designed before. And the second one task is because of economic reasons, there's no possibility, because maybe of technical reason or economic reason, there's no way to build, to modernize existing lines, to build and new lines, especially high-speed line. And this is a source of our projects, our railway projects, which we implemented in this period, 2007-2013. First of all, our main projects are co-financed by operational program infrastructure and environment. This is a program which is financed by cohesion fund. And the second one, the second source of European fund is regional operational program. This is a program which is financed by European Regional Development Fund. And the next sources are state budget and our own sources, and maybe in future, the public-private partnership. There's some information about the program, operational program, infrastructure and environment. The allocation of European Union is about 3.1 billion euro. It is equals to 12.4 billion zlotys, and the rest. This is a contribution of Polish state. As I said before, this is one of our main targets to build high-speed lines in Poland. Our assumption is that in this period of financing, I am talking about the period 2007-2013, we would like to finance or co-finance with European Union the preparatory works for two lines. The first line is from Warsaw to Łódź and Wrocław-Poznań. And the second line is we call E65 SOS. This is a line between Warsaw and Kraków, Katowice. And we in this financial period would like to concentrate on preparatory work, especially feasibility study for the line Warsaw-Łódź, Wrocław-Poznań, and some small feasibility studies for railway junction in Poznań, in Wrocław, and Łódź. And this is our main task for high-speed railway in Poland. Shortening of travel time from the biggest agglomeration in Poland to less than 2 hours, from center of Poland to border regions up to about 3 hours, and from west to east and from north to south of Poland up to 5-6 hours. And providing for 80% of Polish citizens an access to high-speed trains in the time of transfer to the nearest high-speed station, not longer than 1 hour. As I said before, we are planning two stages of this investment. The first stage is preparatory works, which we would like to finish till 2014. And the second stage is the construction. We would like to finance this project in the next financial period, 2014-2020. And as you can see, there are some working papers or some settlements about the line of high-speed railway, especially to connect Poland with Germany, with Berlin, and Wrocław to Prague, and the second line from Warsaw is 65. So from Katowice and from Kraków to Prague and Vienna. So this is a part of discussion in Visegrad group. So this is our initial estimation of the costs which would like to spend in the next financial period 2014-2020. On the list of main projects there are 24 tasks, 24 investment, 24 projects, which we estimate that the cost of the of this project is about 30 billion zloty. And the next part is very important, ERTMS for main projects. In contrary to the present period when some railway projects are implemented without ERTMS, we assume that all projects, railway projects in next financial period will be connected with the implementation of ERTMS. This is a system, and this is also not only a goal, a target for Poland, but also for European Union. This is a system which allow to cross the borders without stopping, without changing the locomotive, without changing the driver. So this is a important point in our plans. And the third, but I think it's very also important, as I have mentioned, high-speed railway. This is the cost at this stage of construction. We estimate at the level of 20 billion zlotys. So as you compare these figures, 30 billion zlotys and 20 billion zlotys, and if you compare to the expenditure which we plan to spend in present period of financial, it means that we should double or maybe triple money on transport to implement all these projects, which are, in our opinion, necessary not only for Poland, but also for European Union. And this is the future, our plans till 2040. We plan that a new corridors from Warsaw to Białystok and from Warsaw to Lublin and Rzeszów will be built in the future, and the high-speed line and high-speed railway will connect the cities on the east of the Poland. Thank you for attention.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Kazimierczak. This was really impressive, and that showed quite well how much is still to be done in several member states in this regard in Poland to have what we really want to have in future. Of course, we are talking about high-speed railway system all over Europe, and that's good that you mentioned we want to have the possibility to go through with one train without changing the locomotive at the border, what we do have to do still right now. And of course, a lot of money is needed for financing this. And, well, we mentioned already the 10T. I didn't mention it before because I think everybody who is in the room right now knows about 10T, and we have a discussion on 10T revision after the summer break. and the TEN-T is everybody waits for the core network for Europe that shall be proposed by the Commission, because a core network shall just be a connection through whole Europe and connect the main cities and the main economic regions and so on. And of course, everybody wants to have his own city, his own region in the core network. And then we have to concentrate on which pilot priority projects should really be financed in future. So it will be an interesting thing we have to discuss after the summer break. But right now I'll come to my next speaker, because first we have the presentations and then we have time for question and answers. My next speaker is Mark Smeets. He now is from Belgium. And right now he is responsible for the management of the Belgian railway infrastructure, with more than 12,000 employees. Before this, he had been engaged with Thales International, with the finance and financing and administration as a director. Before that, he was an assistant treasurer of the SNCB, and before that, he had been financial advisor of the SNCB. So he's a quite experienced man in the transport business as well. And yes, please, Mr. Smeets, you can. Well, ready for your presentation.
Thank you very much. A small correction, I am not in charge of the company Infrabel. I am just the CFO, financial director, but that's also a difficult sector. Ladies and gentlemen, it's with pleasure that I accepted the invitation to present a few ideas on the topic of PPP, public-private partnerships. Although the time slot is rather short, while professional seminars on this subject take usually 1 or 2 days of explanations, but this is not the objective today. I will not comment complicated structures of a PPP, the way of the tendering process is organized, or general contents of a DBFM agreement, and so on. Now, my presentation is the result of some reflections and real experience at the site of a public body who set up 2 PPPs in the past, a couple of years ago. PPPs that are running for the time being. And we know often a PPP doesn't turn out as easy as the actors were dreaming about. It's not a miracle solution. We heard there's, we need a lot of money for railway infrastructure in general in each country, and PPP is an alternative way of financing besides public subsidies. But you will see it's not a miracle. Perhaps public bodies should be more prepared and should exchange experiences between each other before starting these complicated and sensitive constructions. At the private sector, people who work in there are professionals. The public sector has to be professional too. In any case, we learned a lot of our experience, and I would like to share that with you. We have, as Infrabel, a relatively extended investment program each year for railway infrastructure. We have more than 150 projects at the same time, smaller, greater. And sometimes it happens that a particular project could better be done by an alternative funding like a PPP, rather than by public yearly subsidies. So we'll try, Infrabel, to learn something to people who are trying to set up a PPP, and I will do it through some general comments. What's a PPP? Explain you how we see a PPP. This is something you can learn in all booklets about it. Our approach of a PPP, how did we do it? What are important messages still from the public side? And then a few words about our 2 projects, the Diablo project and the Liefkenshoek rail connection in the port of Antwerp. You see a structure at the screen where the essential thing is mentioned, a description of a PPP. Well, it's a structured collaboration between two parties, a public body and a private entity, private body. Not just a collaboration for 1 year during the negotiation, not for 4 or 5 years during the construction, but for 30 to 40 years when the operational phase starts and is running. When you set up a PPP, the objective is the financing and the accelerated execution of an important project, roads, railways, others. And what you should try to do is to create added value for both parties. So it's a very long-term marriage. You can't set up that with a view on short-term. You have to work for a very long-term. And all this is made concrete by, in general, a DBFM agreement, which covers the words design, build, finance, maintain. That's basic. What are the elements we see in a PPP? Just very general. It's a long-term financing, yes. It's an alternative financing coming from outside. You can set up the project with respect of deadlines, budget, and timing. And it can go faster than if you do it on the classical way. You have to put the stress, a best effort on risk evaluation and transfer of risk between parties. That's essential in a PPP because it has a big influence on the cost of the operation. Put the risks where it should be. I'll tell you something more in the following slides. And then our experience in the public sector is that this kind of transactions need a very good project management. It's a turnkey project, is delivered as a whole, and we don't be used to work on that way. We have always projects in different steps. This, a PPP, is a whole project in one step. So it's a cultural evolution, and we were surprised how people did discover that on the public side. Advantages, just a short list. You will have for your project detailed specifications for the design, and the design will be made by the private partner based upon these specifications for the entire project. This will allow you to create transparency and optimization of costs. The financial model is clear for both partners. And of course, the objective is to have a better compliance with the construction period and the whole cost of the construction. No surprises, everything is in it. You know at the signing what you will pay for. And then again, that risk allocation between the two partners. And the art is to accord these risks to both parties in function of the ability of each partner to bear the risk at the lowest cost. And that's what in general in the booklets is called value for money. The pictures you are seeing on the slides are coming from our two PPPs, eh? Just general comments. I told you a PPP is a real partnership on a very long term. Please keep that in mind. And at the start, often people say, well, let's use a PPP because it could help for the budgeting. I've written on the slide, it's not the best argument, other people will say, do never that. You need a well-defined project. If it's not well-defined, you have a bad start. So you need to have a good description of your project, good knowledge of the project. You have to know yourselves what could be the problems during the construction period and afterwards. You have to put in place, together with your private partner, a clear planning to list all the risks, to prevent that there could be hidden risks. There are always surprises, yes, but please avoid them as much as possible. And as it's a project that will take a long preparation time, you need assistance by external people. The setup costs are very important, so we could recommend that a project should have a minimum size, in our opinion, but it's not an absolute amount, but I would say 50 million is a minimum. If you do it below, it could be risky. You could lose money. We paid a lot of attention to the rules of Eurostat, and I'll explain you afterwards why it is. Eurostat is very concerned by the respect of the budgets of the national states, and this should be done also through these PPP transactions. Another thing, clear and single vision of the public sector. What does that mean? If you have contradictions between federal government or other public bodies about the project, or you are changing your mind during the execution, this is very, very pity for the project. Clear and single vision, and you must go for it. We don't think that linking two or more projects within a single PPP is a good idea. Please make one PPP per project. It could be a big project, but don't link it to other risks with other parties, because then it's becoming very complicated. I told you negotiations take several years. We invested 3 years per deal. You have to make 3 people for that, constitute a team, and be ready for the effort. And during that period, please keep control on external communication, because if someone somewhere tells things that are not correct on the project, it could have impact on the cost of the project. And it creates uncertainty. You have to avoid that. This is linked to transparency during the process. And all these things together make me say that PPP is not a miracle solution. It's a solution. It's a solution for certain very interesting projects. If you're making the effort, if you do it well, you have a big chance to have success. Next slide, organization of the public partner. Some things I have already told them. We had an experience ourselves in Frabel with a tendering process separately for the works and for the financing of these works. So we talked separately with partners, building firms, and the other side investors. And we brought them together afterwards. It was a good experience, but a very difficult one. So my recommendation, do it in the normal way, tendering together the works and the financing. That's what we did in the second deal. External financial legal consultants, but also consultants for market studies. You need a lot of external support. And in order to attract at most as possible candidates for your project, you could better start with an information memorandum with a description of your project, with all the difficulties that are in, with all the possibilities. It must be clear and complete. And this information memorandum is distributed to all possible candidates on the markets. You have to prepare for yourself with your consultants a procedure and the planning for the tender and for the negotiations. A planning for a couple of years. And it's very important that in this planning, you always start with the idea of competition. Competition from the start and competition to the end. The public sector who forgets the competition is driving up the costs. I've spoken about the risks, preparing a risk allocation matrix, technical specification. Don't change your mind afterwards. When you have specifications, decide on them and keep them. You should better make your own estimate of the cost of the project, even if you're wrong, but then you have a rough idea. I must say, our specialized engineers, two times they made a very, very good estimate. And that helps, because in the talks with candidates, you can use that as your reference. You need an internal project team, a strong team, with legal people, financial people, operational people, technical people, and a good spirit in that team. And above that, you need a decision structure, because during the negotiations, fast decisions are welcome. If you ask each time 1 month before deciding, you will never arrive at the end, I think so. Eurostat, I will be short, because this is certainly well known in this circle. Eurostat started with some general principles for PPP, and in general there are three groups of risks. The construction risk should always be at the site of the private sector, the complete construction risk. And they have to take one out of two other kinds of risks, the availability risk or the demand risk. Availability risk is more conservative. This has to do with the quality of the maintenance of the infrastructure. So the private partner has to assure the maintenance for many years. He can do it because he knows the job, and he's paid if the quality is still good. So this is a periodic payment of the public sector in function of the quality of the work. The other offers certain possibilities to the private partner to have a bit more, the demand risk. He's paid in function of the use of the infrastructure by a direct payment of the client's toll or a shadow toll, where the public sector is paying according to the number of users of the infrastructure. Both are possible, but in that case, you need to have a very good market study for the future. Eurostat made also a scheme. This has been translated by the Flemish PPP Knowledge Center in Belgium. Very short, you need an entity to be in charge of the project, and this entity is the private or public company who will manage that for many years. It should be an institutional entity with an autonomy or own sets of accounts. They can be a public entity, it's not excluded, but if it's a public entity, you must be aware that the public entity should be in the same time a market unit. That means having more than 50% of the production costs that are covered by their own revenues. If all these conditions are not fulfilled, then you could have a problem of impact on the budget of the governments. So you have to take into account these principles and to study them before starting. And then about risks, I told you it's a very, very important item during the negotiation. The public sector has to prepare its own mind about risks, to define them, to describe them clearly in the contracts, to allocate them between partners. And an example of this approach is that, for instance, the construction risks is completely at the private sector side, but there are exceptions. You can't ask the private partner to be responsible, even if there are modifications on the demands of the client and works would change. That's something the public sector should cover. Well, the second item is a bit curious. Default of the public sector. You may never have a default on the public sector, but it could happen. Problems with underground. In all these cases, you take the risk at the public sector by paying an indemnification. In other cases, you can give more delay for the works. Force majeure, of course. Force majeure, no private party can find an insurance, I think, for force majeure. Well, after these principles, general things, and I know I am too short, but something about the Diablo project in 3 slides. It's a project, a railway project, of course, to improve the access to the National Airport of Brussels by making an underground link, 2 tunnels of a bit more than 1 kilometer, between the line Brussels-Leuven, as you can see below on the slide. In fact, I'll try to show it, yes. It's the green link I'm showing there between the railway station at the airport, the actual railway station underground, and the new line in the middle of the motorway E19. We built a new line in the middle of the motorway. You saw it already, I think so. And the underground link is ready too. Now, for the time being, we are putting the tracks in the tunnels, and we will achieve the works by the end of this year, beginning of next year. It should allow to have all possible links in the center of Belgium by train between Antwerp, Brussels Airport, Liège, or Cologne, Liège, Brussels Airport, Brussels, Antwerp, Mons, Charleroi. You can go everywhere by crossing the national airport. So this is important after the what's done in other countries linking a main airport to the railway. But unfortunately, it was a bit complicated. I will not comment this slide, but you see there are a lot of partners involved. And my message that you shouldn't link 2 projects within 1 PPP, we were almost in that situation. The Flemish region asked to do roadworks with the same building companies as the companies who are working for us. So we asked and we obtained 2 separate PPPs. One of the Flemish region, the other of Infrabel. But there is a link by the building firms. Some financial information on this deal. The PPP is worth for 290 million. This is a fixed amount. It won't change. It will not be indexed, neither. And Infrabel is doing the new line in the center of the motorway E19 for 250 million. The PPP part is given to a special purpose vehicle, Norton Diablo, and they put in place an equity risk capital of 11.5% of the deal, and the rest is done by bank loans. And as you can see, the start of the rail works is very recent. The civil works are done, and the commercial operation will be, I hope so, the 10th of June next year. And how will it be paid? By three sources of income. Infrabel is paying every year 9 million. The operators, railway operators, are paying a percentage of the turnover. And each passenger is paying a supplement per journey. So this is a PPP with a demand risk. The second one is bigger but easier. The Liefkenshoek rail connection in the port of Antwerp. You see a map of the port of Antwerp. It's very schematic. In fact, we are building a railway connection underground, a connection between the right and the left border of the River de Scheldt. In total, it takes 13 kilometers about, two tracks, from which more than 6 kilometers are underground and are crossing three waterways. This is an important link for us because it makes the link between two major railway infrastructure, marshalling yards on the left side and the right side of the River de Scheldt. And it's just a start for larger works afterwards to improve the access from the port of Antwerp to the hinterland. So it's also a part of future corridors for good transport. And the Liefkenshoek rail link is specially intended to improve the transport of containers in the port of Antwerp by train, of course. Well, in the same way, we have different partners working together. A private partner, Locorail, assisted by a building consortium, Locobau, Infrabel as public sector with Turk Rail is engineering company, daughter company, but also the Flemish government, the federal government, and of course, owners of lands in the port of Antwerp who did transfer the ownership of all grounds that we needed. My last slide is also some financial information about this project. 690 million euro, co-financed by the Flemish region for 107 million, and Infrabel will put in place some specific safety infrastructure and rail infrastructure for 75 million. The financing is in the same way, 11.5% of risk capital, the balance by consortium of banks, included the European Investment Bank taking 50% of the senior debt. The works are going on. We did arrive with one tunnel boring machine a couple of weeks ago, so that's done. The second one will arrive within a month, and the commercial operation will start in June 2014. And this is not with a demand risk, this is with an availability risk. So if everything goes well, technically, we will be obliged to pay for it. About 12.6 million quarterly for a long period. So that's my contribution.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Sleet. It was slightly longer than we expected, that's right, because you mentioned it already, but I think we're still in time. Well, of course, and that's why I now make it short to just go to the next speaker. Well, we learned something about tunnels, PPP, and so on. I think I personally would have many questions right away, but I will wait for other questions. And of course, I would like to introduce our third speaker, Richard Abel. And now I hope that the biography I have from you, it's the right one. It's not to another person, because at first I had another name and the same biography. So as far as I know, you are the managing director of Macquarie Infrastructure. That's right?
Yes, I'm the managing director.
Okay, and you joined Macquarie in 2010, and you had to do with, you were a UK civil servant for 16 years, that's right, okay, so it's the right biography I have. And you have been director of energy market policy already, and you run export licensing. So you, in different ways, you tackled these issues we are talking about today, and so we are very much looking forward to what you tell us. You have the floor, please.
Thank you very much. And ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for inviting Macquarie to your deliberations today on these very important subjects. I'm delighted to be here. Macquarie Infrastructure and Real Assets, or MIRA, business is the largest global infrastructure fund manager. Over the last 5 years, Macquarie has raised $32 billion of capital globally for direct investment in infrastructure. That's almost three times more than the second-placed firm, Goldman Sachs, according to Infrastructure Investor magazine. This story all started about 17 years ago in Australia, at similar to now, a period of financial strain in public finances there, where Macquarie saw a practical solution. Government wanted to build things, wanted investment in toll roads and other infrastructure. There was, at the same time, a growing pool of equity because of a compulsory pension savings scheme started in Australia at the same time. And they recognised there was a good match here of long-term capital for long-term infrastructure investments. Now, that story's grown. We've now got over 100 infrastructure companies globally worth about 70 billion euros. 30 companies in Europe, including Brussels Airport, other airports, a third of the French motorway network, gas transmission networks, renewables, communications, and Thames Water, which supplies London's water and waste services. We spent 2.3 billion euros in 2010 alone on capital expenditure at these European companies, renewing and developing Europe's infrastructure, and these companies employ over 45,000 people. Look, all this is to say that we've got quite a good vantage point, I think, for what attracts private finance into infrastructure. And it's that I want to focus on in my remarks today. I won't labour the point about the funding gap between what we want for infrastructure networks and what funding has been identified. We all know it's there. What I will point out is a figure, $65 trillion. $65 trillion is what, in 2009, the OECD study of long-term global infrastructure needs, which Macquarie is very proud to be the lead private sector partner of, that's what they identified as available in pension funds and insurance funds globally. Now, a very small, relatively small proportion of this equity is devoted to infrastructure. More could be. The main point I want to make in the remainder of this presentation is essentially a boring one. The reason it is boring is it's about stability and predictability. The main point I want to make is that what is needed most of all is stable and predictable regulatory frameworks in energy and in transport infrastructure. With those, institutional equity will come into that space. Investors need boring in infrastructure regulatory frameworks. It needs to be stable and predictable. So, and why is that? Well, fundamentally, pension funds and infrastructure are a good match because infrastructure companies, or assets, typically have relatively low risk, relatively low volatility, usually providing essential services with regular revenue streams. These revenue streams are often inflation linked directly or indirectly. So that's a great thing for pension funds and also insurance companies whose liabilities are also linked to inflation typically. Pension funds and insurance companies are better placed than most investors to invest for the long term as well, because they have long-term liabilities. They're not immune to short-term economic cycles, but they are able to take a longer-term view than most. So pension funds are attracted to infrastructure as an asset class in principle, but it will only translate in practice to investment where the regulatory framework is right. But it's worth reminding ourselves that one of the reasons there is a funding gap is historic underinvestment by the public sector in many cases. Now, part of that is because many public sector organisations, though not all, I hasten to add, treat operating expenditure and capital expenditure as fungible or flexible cash. They don't have a balance sheet for the assets. That's been the case in, for example, the metro network, London Underground, where there are still blacksmiths at work on parts of the network, because those parts of the network are so old. Now, if you don't have a balance sheet that's depreciating assets, what happens when budgets are tight and political pressures are high? There's always a temptation to cut capital expenditure first. And that's a lot easier when there's no balance sheet to reference the value of the asset base and the declining value of that asset base as it depreciates. Look, that's bad for future generations. It's bad for long-term investment. But a further key benefit of a balance sheet-based form of regulation is that, combined with independent regulation at arm's length from government, it can form a secure basis for long-term investors to put money into an asset initially, and then continue to invest in it, and continue to put in large amounts of capital expenditure to renew and potentially extend those assets. So that kind of regulated asset base, or RAB model, works well. It balances the interests of investors with consumers. Now, I think you've touched on RAB-based networks in previous evidence sessions. But the essence of it is that when complete with that balance sheet and a value of those assets, as new expenditure is put in place, it's added to the regulatory asset value of the company, and it's given and guaranteed, generally, typically, in law, through a statutory duty on the independent regulator to ensure that capital expenditure can be financed and the company can continue to finance its functions for the future. Because the concern of long-term institutional investors like pension funds and insurance companies whose money we manage is that you make all this big upfront investment, and that later on, as the years go by, something changes and you don't get the return on that investment over time that you expected and were had as the basis of the investment case. So a RAB-based, independently regulated model gives investors relative certainty and protection from political risk. It also incentivizes the companies to perform efficiently. And look, the returns are capped at a reasonable level by the regulator as well, so it's a fair deal for citizens and business consumers who are using and paying, ultimately, in most cases, for these networks. The need for stability and boringness doesn't mean that nothing can ever change in a regulatory framework, but it just means that it needs to be well signalled in advance and mustn't undermine the fundamentals of past investment. The RAB model kind of started in the UK, but it's by no means confined to there. Many European airports have a RAB-based framework with prices based on cost allowances, including capital expenditure. French toll road networks have regulated price increases subject to a capital expenditure requirement. Our investors are attracted to assets like these. We are invested in a number of these places, a number of assets like this across Europe. From an investor perspective, broadly speaking, probably the difference between energy and transport infrastructure assets in this space is that where transport assets are more often exposed directly to GDP risks, so the ups and downs of the economy, and so the investors will tend to look for, you know, a bit of a higher return in those kind of investments rather than energy networks. As broadly speaking, I mean, it does depend on each individual case. Look, briefly, because I know our time is short, three related points I'd want to make. Pension funds are typically attracted to so-called brownfield or existing infrastructure businesses, and you'll have kind of heard that, you know, in previous evidence. But because they're able to throw off cash, to throw off yield straight away, and you know, pension funds, insurance companies have got ongoing liabilities. They've got to keep they've got to issue money every year, so that's attractive to them. But we shouldn't forget this is a really important form of infrastructure investment, in particularly in mature European economies, where there is a large number of aging infrastructure assets in transport, energy, water sectors. So replacement and renewal of existing brownfield networks is really important for European economies, and we shouldn't just think because pension funds are more attuned to greenfield investment, that isn't a really important part of bridging the investment infrastructure funding gap. It's also possible that RAB-based existing networks can accommodate new interconnections between networks and extensions to networks, though there may need to be variations on the theme depending on the size and nature of a particular project. I should also point out that we have, with pension fund investors, taken forward some completely greenfield projects, such as the Gdansk deep sea container port in Poland, which I was delighted to see on the map there, because with new rail and road, improved rail and road links, offers fantastic prospects for better trade connections in the Baltic and further afield. Second point I want to make is in the energy sector, unbundling, an absolutely key part of the third package, which is now in force, is absolutely critical to attracting this institutional investment into energy networks. It's quite a complicated subject, but the key reason is that investment in transmission and distribution networks is a different proposition to investment in energy generation. Energy generation typically has commodity risk associated with it, has more GDP risk that you don't find to the same extent in networks. So regulated, unbundled energy network businesses are very attractive to institutional investors. We've just bought a very large gas distribution network in Germany, gas transmission network in Germany on behalf of institutional investors. And there's a lot of appetite for these and for putting capital expenditure into these networks once acquired. Third, and very briefly, another good thing about private ownership by long-term investors in a RAB-based network is you can get better quality service, as these private owners want to drive out any inefficiencies that are there to improve the service that's given against independent regulated targets. We did that in Thames Water, where it was at the bottom quartile in its performance against the regulator's quality targets when we bought it. It's now in the top quartile. And you know, that's good for consumers as well as good for investors. So my boring message is stable, predictable, independent, RAB-based regulation and unbundled energy networks will attract greater amounts of institutional equity in European energy and transport networks. And that will not need, without requirement for government funding in the majority of cases, because they're user paid. Now, I've almost finished, but I'm going to ask if I can raise one other thing very briefly, and that is the forthcoming Solvency II regulation for the European insurance industry. Now, that's not obviously the main subject of our discussion here today, but the reason I raise it is that in it, and the details are being worked through now by the European Pensions Regulator and by the Commission, in it, infrastructure funds look likely to be classified alongside hedge funds and private equity as a sort of alternative investments. I mean, nothing wrong with, you know, those forms of investment as part of a balanced portfolio, you know, of investments for investors, but they're very different in terms of risk profile. And our concern is that while Solvency II is a complex and wide-ranging package of, you know, measures for the insurance sector, and this is just a small bit of it, there is a risk that if this higher capital charge of 49% is applied to infrastructure funds, we're going to disincentivize European insurance companies from investing in infrastructure through infrastructure funds, which is a kind of popular way for many of them, particularly the small and medium-sized ones who are not big enough to kind of do direct investments, to come into the sector. Anything you can do to encourage policymakers to look hard at sort of maybe finding a way through this, recognising it's, you know, as a big and complex issue? You know, I point out real estate funds are going to be charged at 25%, which we think is a much more sort of appropriate sort of benchmark for infrastructure funds as well. Because it would seem to us to be a real shame and a bit of a public policy own goal if through solvency regulation, perfectly appropriate though it is in principle and in its generality, we disincentivised insurance companies from investing in infrastructure funds. Because we don't want fewer stories like the one I will close on, which is that last month, the largest ever container ship to enter the Baltic Sea docked at our Gdansk port, greeted by former President Lech Walesa and Prime Minister Tusk. That's what private investment can deliver. And we should aim for more of it, not less. I'm delighted to take any questions, I'm sure, along with my colleagues. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Abel. Well, now we have a wide range of presentations, what we saw. We started with the railways in Poland and with the necessity of having more money for the infrastructure needed for high-speed railways. Then we went to tunnels and through ports and so on with public-private partnership, and now it was pension funds and insurance funds. It's a wide range. Exactly. Lena Eck, I just welcome my colleague who is waiting for her panel coming right within 2 seconds or two minutes. Can you borrow us a few minutes? It would be great, because we started with a delay of 15 minutes and now otherwise we wouldn't have any time for question and answers, and I think it would be a pity. So I don't do any questions, because I could imagine that there are several questions in the plenary, and I want to give you a chance to ask the questions to our experts. Adina, I want to say something. Okay, then of course she's the first. Yeah.
Advantages of sitting here. Yes. Well, I very much thank and appreciate all the presentation, even though diverse, all very interesting. But the issue we are tackling, it is diverse. So, what struck me in the first presentation from Poland Railway, let me say correctly, Polish railway network was it was no expectation for private investment.
Yeah.
The other we had then the intermediate step talking about public-private projects investments, and then at the other end we learned very happy that there are a lot of money waiting to be invested in energy or transport infrastructure with two conditions we, the liberals, cherish nevertheless, which is stability of regulatory frameworks and unbundling. So we do share, and this is absolutely a good news. Why you are not looking towards private investments in the railway networks? And then at the other end, the question is, if you would be to map Europe infrastructure, energy, transport, what would you consider to be the most attractive and which would be the less attractive part of this huge networks? So first and...
Thank you. Then I could maybe add one question to our third speaker, because it's something really interests me. You talked about no hidden risk should be in PPP. How could that possibly be? But maybe Mr. Kazmierczak, here, please give the answer.
Thanks a lot for the question. I think that have mentioned in the presentation that in the nearest future, would like to implement maybe this project high speed line with the contribution of private equity. So I think this is a challenge for us, and I think that the free presentation has one point. The presentation, the point is that we should first of all link different sources of financing to implement the project. And as I have mentioned, the projects, the railway projects in the next financial period are so high, maybe three times more expenditure are needed to implement the project, that we, I think this is a necessity to find private investors to co-finance the project. Mm-hmm. So your question is quite right.
The attractive parts of the networks and projects are those where, for existing assets, it's clear how any investment is going to be funded. So it's clear that there's a sustainable path, whether it's consumers, or availability payments from governments, if that's the way a particular project is being funded. It's clear, and the clearest way is generally speaking in when there's an independent regulator, so there's some insulation from short-term, you know, public sector budgetary pressures and a user-paid system. But you know, there are options for quite innovative ways of bringing money to bear in particular projects. For example, the connection of offshore wind in the UK to the grid has been done in a competitively procured process for the wires under the ground. It's attracted good competition, you know, and a good price. Again, it's sort of on unbundled principles. So people will come in. I mean, the one point I would probably make as a general point is where there is public money, government money at work, you want to use it because it's scarce increasingly, where there is either there's particular issues, perhaps there are risks around permitting or planning, or it's perhaps a, you know, an emerging or a more nascent part of the European infrastructure network, where there are reasons why private capital might find it hard to come in. Because what you don't want is where if we think that public sector capital will be competing with our private sector money directly, we won't bid for such projects because there will be social goals, perfectly appropriate social goals, that may mean that the public sector investor will have a different set of economic calculations from the ones we would. So the important thing is to target that scarce resource on those projects where there are risks that the private sector are going to find hard to manage, and don't put it out there in a sort of maybe a kind of vaguer way where we'll think, are we going to have to compete against it, where the bidding costs might not well be returned.
Okay, maybe I can modify my question a little bit to how can you minimize a risk so in order to attract private investors for PPP?
Sorry, I was talking about possible hidden risks. Of course, this is an ideal situation where there are no risks at all that are unknown. But if you are as public sector as client for these transactions aware from existing situations of the past, you have plans, you have experience, you know what's the underground, I think you have to tell it to the private partner because the problem will come up later on. If the private partner knows what are the problems, he can prepare himself. And we had the experience in the Liefkenshoek tunnel of an existing tunnel. A part did exist and was covered, completely covered. We didn't know what was in that tunnel, how it was. Perhaps it was totally lost. And we said it to all the candidates. So they did some research about it, and they found out that probably it would be in a very relatively good shape. And this could lower the costs It permitted us to lower the cost. If you find afterwards, if you don't tell it, and you will find the problem during the works, it could be very costly.
Okay, thank you. Now it is almost the time over for questions. Is there any extremely urgent question? In this case, I can allow maybe one question. Otherwise, I would... it's one. Okay, one question. Please tell your name and maybe institution, and then address the speaker you want to ask, please.
Mon nom, c'est Stella Velique.
Hello, I'm Stella Velique. I'm a European citizen. I'm a physician. I have a question on infrastructure. Now, when I think about infrastructure, I think this is relevant. I'm talking about a concrete example. I live in Belgium. We've seen recently an increase in the number of deadly train accidents. Have we got a problem in Belgium with security systems on the railways? The explanations we've heard from Infrabel was that we were waiting for European security systems, and this was what held back investments. And then from elsewhere we're told, no, that's not really a European problem, that's a problem for national governments. So my question is railway security something that's managed by a European institution, or is it an issue for national governments to deal with? And why do we see this problem? Thank you.
Okay, yes, of course. Answer in French, easy for you.
Alors, ce n'est pas particulièrement...
Well, this is perhaps not my area of expertise, but I'll try to give you an answer that's clear. The system that we will be implementing is the ETCS system, which is subject to a European standard that has been developed. As far as I can tell, that's still being developed. It took some time to develop that system, and this system wasn't installed yet in Belgium. It is the best available system, but because the standards haven't been fully defined, there was an inherent risk of installing a system that may later on have to be modified. Now, the system that you were talking about on is something that is being planned by Infrabel. There's a plan ongoing that will continue on to 2022, which will mean that all of the systems will be brought up to meet existing EU standards. But I do think that more work will need to be done in order to reach a standard that's widely accepted by everyone.
Politician in the European Parliament, we are talking about harmonization in Europe, but it's not always there. And so we have to work on it, of course, as well on safety and transport. Okay, thank you very much for the experts of the first panel. And now I just give the floor to my dear colleague Lena Egg and her experts.
Okay. Dear colleagues and friends, and welcome to the very distinguished panel that we have in this second section. The overall topic is financing the European transport and energy infrastructures and connecting the infrastructures. And of course, this is a major problem, and I've negotiated the third energy market package, energy efficiency for buildings, the energy labeling in the eco design directive, and things like this. So, and of course, the gas and oil infrastructure. There are a number of challenges that we have to face in this area, and we have to do it in a time where we have a financial crisis, a climate crisis, and a jobs crisis, which is, of course, adding to the difficulties, but also adding to the challenges and maybe the possibilities, because what we are also on the verge of negotiating is the strategy on raw materials, and the efficiency in this area, as well as the seven flagship targets in the EU's jobs and strategy for the coming 10 years, the so-called EU 2020 strategy. And of course, the infrastructure is the tool to achieve this, and extremely important in this area. So I won't introduce this panel more than this. We have some, as I said, very distinguished speakers. And if we first start with the gas in infrastructure, and Christophe Bouvier, and of course, in GRT Gas, to be Vice President of the Gas System Division, I'm sure that you have all the solutions, and I'm looking forward to this. We have to stop slightly before 7 o'clock, so 10 minutes each at most. But I'm sure you're also very efficient as persons and speakers. So I'm looking forward to this. Please, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Eck. First of all, I would like to thank ALDE for giving us the opportunity to deliver our messages from gas infrastructure. Maybe I will tell you a few words about what is GIE, Gas Infrastructure Europe. So GIE is a Gas Infrastructure Europe is a representative organization towards European institutions. We've got 66 member companies in 26 countries in Europe. So it's a lot of membership. And these companies are operating gas pipelines, underground storages, and LNG terminals. And we have inside GIE three subdivisions. One for transmission system operators, which is called GTE. One for underground storages operator, which is GSE. And one for gas LNG terminals, which is GLE. And I will go to deliver the messages I wanted to say today. First of all, we've got a big infrastructure challenge. And I would like to recall here the crucial role of gas in the European energy market. First of all, we can say that gas is abundant, affordable, and acceptable for the market. Gas has got an increasing importance because it's an enabler of fuel for variable electricity generation. In addition, we need to bring new gas to Europe due to the decline of the domestic production in the North Sea, for example. And in case we have under investment, it would not only impact security of supply, but it may have consequences on the functioning of the market with the increase of price, for example. In addition, I would say that we need some consistency in the current European energy policy because we have seen some inconsistency which could trend to discourage investors. When the European Commission, for example, recognized the need for more gas infrastructure while advocating scenarios with a decline in gas demand in the long term, it is not very attractive for investors. So we would like to have a more positive political messages, which would be expected from European bodies to favor investment in gas infrastructure and to favor long-term commitments in capacity booking from shippers. If I go to infrastructure priorities now, it's very important for the European market to have a diversified portfolio of physical gas sources and routes. It's security of supply mainly. Once we have said that, we can identify priority corridors, of course, but these corridors should include all kinds of infrastructure, transmission, LNG terminal, and storage infrastructure. And they should not be limited to interconnection between countries, but they should take into account the links inside the core network of countries. Otherwise, you will have some holes in the system. And if we consider new financing instruments, they should not be limited to projects which would be on a shorter priority list or European priority list, because here there is the danger of introducing two different tiers for infrastructure projects, and we consider that's not very good. Then if I go to the financing issues, which is the main concern today, first of all, as infrastructure operator, we need a sound investment climate and a stable regulatory framework, which are the prerequisite for the development of gas infrastructure. And if we consider European funding, this is possible, but it should not be a remedy for inadequate national regulatory framework. It is very important to have appropriate regulatory framework, which would provide incentives and long-term visibility, and which are clear and in keeping with a long-term policy perspective and cross-border approach. And we need a cross-border approach between regulators too, which is very important when we want to develop cross-border projects. These cross-border projects are special for infrastructure investors because they are representing an increased risk for investment, because in this project we are involving several countries. There is an increased complexity, and the length of project is increased too. The higher risk today is not considered in regulated tariffs. And in addition, you have discrepancies in regulatory framework between countries, which is an additional difficulty when we want to implement such project. If we go now to the idea of new financial tools, okay, this can be, but in any case, a priority when we talk about project, priority should be given to market-based project. When I say market-based project, it means project we can go only with the market, the commitments from the market. We could imagine public finance, but it should be limited for specific projects, which, for example, would be justified from security of supply priorities or solidarity perspectives. And I would say that if we think about cheaper financing, it is not often the case solution to take investment decision in our business, which is a regulated business. If we want in infrastructure, in energy infrastructure development, if we want to facilitate investment decision, it's very important to have long-term commitments in the booking of capacities. And for this, we need clarity, stability, and visibility in the market. And this is very important to limit commercial risk for infrastructure. And this is more and more difficult because market players are focusing more and more on short term today. We can imagine to facilitate investment decision mechanism, incentivizing mechanism, for example, create a premium rate on the return in each national regulation framework for specific investment. This could be, for example, for investment inside the priority corridor. Or we can imagine other incentivizing measures, which could be, for example, shortened amortizing periods or anticipated startup dates when dealing with regulation and tariffs. And in addition, because it is a problem for lots of our members, there is too much short-term focus in regulatory frameworks on cost reduction, and this doesn't help the taking of investment decisions on big infrastructure. So I thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you. That's very clear and to the point. I look at my colleagues, Adina-Ioana, who negotiates, and Gesine Meissner, who also is into these dossiers. Do you have questions right now? No? Could I ask, in that case, when you make an investment in the big grid, for how many years do you envisage a payoff time? I mean, there are different, like, key figures in different sectors of the industry.
Yeah, I would say, I think it depends on the country. I could take the example of France, for example. If we
it's
want,
good example.
Because it is, it is the one I know the best. If we want to develop an interconnection with another country, for example, we are asking the market to just to know what, which level of capacity market players are able to book, and what we require is a booking on 10 years, and a commitment on 10 years. And just to give you a figure of comparison, we consider that the life of a gas pipe is 50 years, more than 50 years.
Okay, and if you go into the smaller grid,
yes,
more closer to consumer.
In that case, if we go to the development of national grids for consumer, then if I take again the example of France, we are forced to build the pipe for the consumer. If a consumer wants to go, for example, a new power plant, we have the obligation to do the investment and to connect the plant to the grid. And then the investment can be split. The investment is always taken into account in the regulated tariff, and then we are paid back through the tariff. So it means that we are paid back during.
So the tariff regulations are very important.
For us, it's very important. Yes, in some country, it is the tariff regulation is in such bad condition that the TSOs don't want to invest because they lose money if they invest. So it's difficult for them to develop the network, and it can be a big problem. Yeah.
If we look at different sectors of the society where gas can be used, it's industry, it's housing, but it's also in transport. How do you look at the different investments for different sectors?
We deliver gas to a very large panel of consumers, of course. And as GIE, I'm representing transport companies. So our business stops when we are delivering gas either to big customers, mm-hmm. big industry, mm-hmm. or to local distribution companies. Mm-hmm. For example, if we the delivery to transport companies for buses or cars is made through distribution companies, so it's very far from our business, and I'm afraid I cannot answer.
I know it's very far, but what we have to face is, of course, when we look at the transport sector, as gas and biogas in a combination for trucks and private cars and so on, and that would be if you look at the potential volume consumed. You were talking about the visions of the Commission and different scenarios. I mean, in some of these scenarios, it's quite a big volume.
And yes, of course, and would be in any case would say very happy if there is development of gas consumption for transport. For example, or if there is a development of biogas, it would be an extra activity for transmission system, for example. It means more capacities in the network, so not necessarily more money for us, but it could lead to a better use of all the networks and some decrease in the tariffs.
Yes. How do you look at new entrants? Last question. How do you look at new entrants? Not the last questions, but how do you look at new entrants?
New entrants as shippers or?
Using the grid.
Using the grid, we welcome them very much.
Technique, standards?
As I would say the user of the grids are, I think it's very challenging to have a market which is opening with all these people asking questions of what, how do you, and asking questions about how we do our business, and I think it's a way to improve what we do.
Thank you. Mrs. Valian.
Thank you. I'm thinking that the transport infrastructure for gas, or generally, if I might say so, the transport infrastructure plays a key role for a European market in that sector. How do you see the European market for gas from this perspective? What is still needed in terms of infrastructure to improve, to try to improve or to complete the European market for gas?
Yes, I think the ENTSO-G has published recently its work on the 10-year development plan, which gives a picture of what could be necessary for the European grid. I think what is important to take into account is that even if we consider that the consumption is not increasing, there would be a need for development of the transmission system for two reasons. The first one is because the sources of gas will change. For example, the North Sea sources will decrease and we will need to import gas from other sources, so it means new connections. And another reason is that there is a need for more flexibility in the system, because a consequence of the opening of the market is that we have created market zones in all countries, and in this market zone, in some of these market zones, the gas can flow freely. So there are more possibilities given to gas shippers in the system. And in addition, if you consider the new development of gas, for example, for electricity generation, it is a special way of consuming gas for industrial customers, because electric plants start every morning and stop every evening. So you have an annual consumption which is not so important, but you need a gas infrastructure to transport the gas, and you need gas infrastructure to adapt the system to the flexibility needed for the functioning of these plants. And in some countries, in addition, we see that the gas is used in power plants as a substitution to wind power plants. For example, when the wind stops in a country, the electricity generation is simultaneously switching to gas-fired power plant. And for gas infrastructure operator, it means that we need to move big quantities of gas from a place to another place, and it means that we have to develop our infrastructure for that.
Mm-hmm. That's a challenge to be sometimes the balancing factor.
Yes, and it's difficult to explain that even if the consumption is flat, we need more infrastructure. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Very quick, because we have two more, and.
For the at the end, just about the role of gas storage in this whole picture you just described. Do you think it's developed enough, the sector? Is it still room for improvement? Is it need for financement from European level?
Could we save that till after the three presentations? Because it might be that you all have comments on this. Thank you. Because I want to move on to the electric grid and the ENTSO-E, and we are lucky to have Mark Copley here, who is an energy economist and who has advised the ENTSO-E on three areas: the development of the first European-wide legally binding network codes for capacity allocation and congestion management. Very difficult and interesting. The progressive harmonization and coupling of regional European markets, indeed interested, and the conditions required to allow Europe's TSOs to finance the considerable volumes of investments in transmission infrastructures. And that's right on the spot. So I give you 10 minutes from now, please.
Thank you very much indeed. I'll try and stick to those 10 minutes. What I want to do is explain a little bit about what ENSOE is, what we do, and then talk a little bit about the challenges which our members face. I am probably going to repeat much of what both the previous two speakers have said, which should make me be quick. Now, I work for the European Network of Transmission System Operators for Electricity. This means that I represent 41 transmission companies, the organisations that own high voltage wires across Europe, and they come from 34 European countries. In total, they serve over 500 million customers and own over 300,000 kilometres of line. As you can imagine, that means they face very different challenges and that they prioritise very different things. But ENSOE isn't just an organisation that works for its members. Since the introduction into force of the third energy package, we have legal obligations as well. So ENSOE is working to deliver security of supply on a pan-European basis by sharing best practice and making sure that what we do is as efficient as it can be. We're trying to deliver the transition to a low-carbon electricity sector in Europe by connecting large volumes of renewable generation of all sorts and of all sizes. And my particular job, we're trying to develop competitive markets that reduce prices to consumers, reduce risk for investors, and ultimately benefit all of us. So, where are we today? And what are the challenges that we're facing? I think we're at an important point. We're talking about assets which have a 20 to a 50 year lifetime. And we're at a point where we need to make some big decisions about where Europe's grid is going. The decisions that we make today are going to affect us for the next 40 or 50 years. And the point we're starting from is fairly complicated and fairly diverse. Every member state deals with its energy sector differently. It has different priorities. It has different objectives. It has different ways of regulating those businesses. That makes it difficult for investors, and in some cases, it makes it difficult for the TSOs. But the point we need to bear in mind is that moving to this low-carbon economy, which I think we all want to achieve, really requires a paradigm shift. It is a change in every aspect of our members' business. We're moving from a world where we move generation to meet demand to a world where we're going to have to move demand to meet generation. The whole sector is being turned on its head. And what that means is that we need to create the conditions to invest. Without investment, it will be very, very difficult, if not impossible, to realise these three policy goals. And if I may, I'd like to briefly touch on the scale of the challenge. This comes from our 10-year network development plan, which is our biannual summary of Europe's transmission investment need. Now, what you can see on this diagram is both that the amount of money involved is quite staggering and that the amount of wires that need to be built is fairly scary, particularly in a world where it's difficult to get things built because of planning and permitting purposes. You can see there that each of those three policy goals requires significant cross-border investments to deliver them. And we can't forget that those investments take place at the same time as many of our existing grids are reaching the end of their life. So we need to make sure those grids are maintained and replaced as well. So according to our estimates, we're talking about a 23 to 28 billion investment need to 2015 and up to 100 billion in total. People could argue about the exact nature of those numbers, but they're staggering. Now, Historically, people have been attracted to TSO businesses. They've seen them as low risk, they've brought in the pension funds and the insurance companies that our colleague from Macquarie explained earlier. But there are some new and different challenges facing Europe's transmission businesses. We've got unpredictable and complex permitting processes. It can take up to 10 years to get a line built, and that will typically involve large amounts of protests, of reputational risks, which people may not wish to be associated with. We're also building grids which are quite different from the grids we built in the past. If you think of an offshore network, if we're going to make the North Sea dream a reality, it's going to need some new technologies, and investors don't always like taking on that new technology risk. We're also living in a world where there have been some fairly large policy changes, and where much of the generation we're connecting relies on support to go forward. So we need to make sure those frameworks are very stable and people have confidence in them. And then there's the regulatory frameworks themselves. Ultimately, the vast majority of this investment need will be paid for by customers through national tariffs. In order to make that number as low as possible, it's important that people have confidence that those regulatory regimes will provide returns which are proportionate to risks, and perhaps most importantly, that they won't change in future. In much of Europe, what our members are saying is that is not the case. And finally, we're dealing with many more cross-border investments, which means working together, it means overcoming challenges around different regimes. And again, that isn't as easy as replacing an existing line in your country, which creates an incentive to do the easy stuff first and means that the pan-European significant stuff perhaps doesn't get delivered as quickly as we would all like. So, risks are rising and the investment challenge is significant. What needs to be done? The first thing to say is we're really pleased that the energy infrastructure package has come along at the moment. It's a real opportunity to make some significant changes in a few areas. And I'm going to highlight four of those areas. The first one is planning and permitting reform. We don't want people to have less of a say, but we do want there to be more predictability and more stability about when and how permits will be granted. If that means a one-stop shop, if that means fewer organisations, that would be beneficial. We need to balance the requirements of Europe as a whole and of local individuals and make sure we have streamlined processes. The second point is the being boring issue we heard about earlier. We really have to make sure that those regulatory regimes are boring, that the investors have confidence that they're not going to change tomorrow or in 5 years or in 10 years. Because it's only that that's going to bring in those investment volumes we need. And within those frameworks, we need returns which are proportionate to risks. As I've said, I believe the risks are increasing. If the regulatory regimes are not flexing to reflect those risks, there are plenty of other places, other sectors, other continents where that investment can go. And finally, we have to remember that we want to create a grid in 2050 which can meet even more stretching renewable targets than we will have in 2020, 2030 and beyond. That means we have to invest now in innovation, in research and development, so that we find those innovations that can drive down costs in the long term. So to reiterate, we welcome the infrastructure package. We like the fact it seems to be targeting these four areas. We urge everybody in this room to do what they can to make those to make progress in those areas so that those three goals of security of supply, of connecting renewables, and of creating competitive markets can become a reality. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I would have thought that you were more boring than Greece, for example, but maybe I'm wrong. Maybe we should have European energy bonds. Now that we started with other kinds of bonds. Thank you for the presentation. Very clear and just sort of urging us to go back to business and get it done with. Don't you agree, Adina? And I also welcome Yorgo Chatzimakakis, who is also in the ITRE committee and have negotiated also a number of dossiers in this area. Comments? Yeah.
Well, thank you for the presentation. It's good for us to be reminded and focused on what is important, because the subject is very vague. It's huge, and there is a tendency in the House to dissipate into many areas. So, as I was saying at the beginning of this afternoon, what I fear most is not to go in a direction which I would harm economy and the possible development of the market. Now, there is this talk about how do we finance the needed infrastructure. But in terms of needed infrastructure, maybe you can elaborate a bit. What do you see it is needed at this stage for completing the European grid?
I'm afraid the answer is quite a lot. Our 10-year network development plan, which was the first comprehensive study of the cross-border investment needs in Europe, identified, I think, over 200 projects where there was existing congestion on borders. And where that congestion exists, we can't make the market work as effectively as it ought to. So what I think is needed is much of what's being done. That's identifying some priority corridors, taking action to put in place financing mechanisms which can target specific risks which member countries will face, but recognizing that the vast majority of this investment will need to come, as it has historically, through user tariffs, and trying to do what can be done to make sure those frameworks are stable. And one point I would like to stress, as I said, we're starting from 27 different points. The challenges each of these countries faces are not the same. We need to make sure we've got a range of tools available so that the risks faced in a Bulgaria or an Estonia or a Britain or a Spain, which are all different, can be targeted appropriately so that we can get concerted development across Europe towards this competitive, integrated energy market.
Okay. Thank you. We come back. And now to the other, the reversed end, the housing sector. And we've been used to think about housing as using energy, but I was, till a couple of years ago, a member of the board of a company who built a five-story apartment buildings that would actually add into the grid. Mm-hmm. So it's fascinating new technology. And we are so lucky to have Claire Rumi here to talk about this very dynamic sector. Please.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak on behalf of Securitas Housing Europe, which is a European network for affordable social, public, and cooperative housing providers. So it's a very wide range of housing providers. All together, they are representing 12% of the housing stock in Europe. And indeed, we see that kind of a revolution in our sector that we have been seeing so far as end consumers, and that we are beginning to see that we can be a producer and adding to the grid. And this is where we see the future. But I think that more than really stick on what I had planned to say, because many things have been said already, which I can really agree with, then I can maybe react on two things that I think we have missed so far. If there is a lack of private investors in infrastructure, energy and transport infrastructure needs, we have to ask ourselves if it's because we communicate so badly about the needs, or it's if it is because there is a real problem. And I believe there is a real problem, because a real problem is that we tend to think about energy production and consumption in a very traditional way. And investors do not believe that it is the future. And I really think that we have a mismatch into saying we need. I'm not saying that all the what has been identified by the European Commission in terms of congestion is not needed. It is needed. There is congestion. There is problems in cross-border. There will be needs. But we are not good enough in providing real assessment of what are the needs. We have done the calculation. If you invest 4 trillions of euro in the residential stock of Europe, you decrease the entire need of energy in the residential sector by more than 60%, knowing that it's the currently 40% of the energy needs are in the residential sector. So this choice has not been made yet, whether you invest in energy efficiency and make buildings become completely passive or positive buildings, or if you really invest into grids and to more energy needs. And I think that the investors, they look at the picture, and so far they just see that we are not honest on what do we very really need and on what kind of path we want to take. That's the first problem for the investors. The second problem for the investors, it has been already said by most of the speakers before, it's the problem of permits, of obligations, regulations, and all this that is changing, and the fact that it takes a lot of time because of social acceptance. We never worked on that, and nothing is coming out of any European regulation, European legislation, European initiative to work on the social acceptance. Today, it is what is a major problem for any new energy infrastructure to get out of the ground. It's not to get the money. It's to get people agree on the fact that there is a need to build a very big, huge pipe in their garden. Why? Because, again, we are not honest enough on the needs. And we see that especially in our stock, in the social housing stock, we see that there is a complete technological fatigue. People don't want anymore to have meters, smart meters, because they have been having already 10 different ones in the 10 last years, and none of them have increased their energy efficiency, and all of them have just increased their energy bill. So what do you want to convince people for? I mean, this is just not possible. So I think these two major bottlenecks are not technical and needs to be addressed. And I really would say that we need to be absolutely honest about the needs. What do we want to have as an energy mix in the future? I'm not saying we will not need gas in the future. We will need gas in the future. But we can also have much more district heating as pipes. We can't size the pipes before to have an idea about the needs. And I think that's maybe the most important message I wanted to put across after listening to the others. What other message I had planned to give you is there is very good examples on how indeed to incentivize and also to work on the social acceptance with current EU funds. And we are working now with 4% of the structural funds can be devoted to social housing and to refurbish social housing in Europe. In countries like France, where they have used this possibility to increase energy efficiency and renewables, so it's really like putting renewables into the grids, putting solar panels, do refurbishment. What it means is a decrease of energy bills of all social tenants first, but structural funds have been incentivized in France with 4% of the ERDF. It has led to 1 billion investment in the housing sector, in refurbishment, which leads to more than 15,000 jobs locally. And I think this is also the last kind of message I wanted to put across, is that the problem we have in the European scene is that we want a European market. But the future of energy market, is it European or local? And I think that This is a total contradiction in which you are, in which we are all, because the future of the European internal energy market is more probably to be a very local energy market with a lot of different connections in between those local markets than anything else. And I believe that it's because of that that we are also failing in making sure that we convince investors. The structural funds is a very good example where it has been used in the social housing sector. It's working very well. Another example, sorry, about the needs and the fact that we are not very clear about how much we will need. Today, the European Commission has released its proposal for an energy efficiency directive. In this energy efficiency directive proposal, they want to ask all energy suppliers to reduce by 1.5% the final consumption. So how do you have this directive that is saying to energy suppliers you have to find to decrease the end energy use, and in the same times asking to energy providers to plan for energy infrastructure to be expanded exactly. There is other examples about EU funds, and that I know that the future multi-annual financial framework that you will have soon to debate very hardly in the European Parliament will propose to really hire the share of what is currently called innovative financial instruments with structural funds, meaning basically to use it as guarantee or as revolving funds, and they want to put 10% of the EU budget, or obviously we need to wait for the final proposal, to really increase that capacity of EU money to become in of revolving funds, and I think that's a very key potential for energy infrastructure in the future. However, EU regulation and EU financial regulations are not appropriate to the kind of investments we need, and here I join my colleagues speaking before, because indeed it's not so much public money we need, it's really much more about regulatory frameworks and security in investment. As far as we have seen, when the public money is trying to help the infrastructure, then it basically at the end it costs the same. So something is wrong, because when you have public money, you have so much requirements binding to that at the end the cost is finally the same. And I think I stopped there because I've more or less covered what I wanted to say. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Very intriguing with the French example, French again being a good example. questions? Yorgo Shotimakakis.
Yeah, thank you very much. First of all, I totally agree with what you say. Housing and especially isolations and things like that, refurbishment is a wonderful possibility to go for energy efficiency. Now, country I know best is Germany. In Germany, we actually have the problem within the coalition of the government that one party, my party, or at least my party president, I don't totally agree with what he says, says we can't afford this. It's what Mr. Oettinger is going to propose on energy efficiency, especially on housing, is not affordable, no money. So your proposal on financing goes very much on cohesion funds, on funding, EU funding. What about these countries like Germany, where there is not funding, EU funding not foreseen for housing? What can we do there? I mean, we have KfW, I know, but do you have other elements in mind or other proposals from other member states?
Well, there is a lot of potential indeed in different financial engineerings and financial instruments. I think Germany will soon change its mind because KfW have just said that they will stop financing energy efficiency in housing in Germany. So obviously we have seen announced. So KfW, it's a bank which was using the public guarantee to help all private households to refurbish their house and to a very, very low rate, meaning that it was extremely easy for everybody to really get financing its own home refurbishment. And this is really the best model. It works very well for private households to improve their housing conditions and to decrease their energy consumption. But because KfW has no more the support of the government to do so, then they will stop their programs. And then I think the German government will soon ask EU money to replace KfW systems. But this kind of revolving funds is a great potential. But it's not the only one. There is also the with energy efficiency, what you can do is that you can finance easily with energy bills reduction. The only problem is that you need to find a third financer. We call it the third financing body, because usually the households cannot put the money because they already have mortgage, and especially now it's not the time to put more mortgage on mortgage. So it's then you have to find a public or financial institution who is doing the investment and get repaid directly by the energy bills reduction. And it can be paid, but it has to be paid only on 20 years. So you need to find a very good system. Or you can also sell your energy efficiency certificates, and then it goes into the white certificates kind of mechanism where you can sell your carbon reduction. Sorry.
Yes, white certificates is something that we don't have on a European basis, but has been discussed and mentioned in connection with the emission trading system, for example, and also with connection with energy efficiency. That would also provide a possibility also for energy companies or the big companies providing the net. So there is a possibility to use this. Some countries have this, but most of the member states not. I know you have to catch one question that Adina Valian brought forward just a couple of minutes ago that connects with this, because in some regions they plan to use the housing as balancing power because of new technology, as you mentioned, but also because of new business models. And there are even car companies planning to use big trucks as balancing power at certain workplaces and so on. And that brings me to back, and we have the gas and we have the question of balancing big, like the North Sea wind power mill plants. So the balancing would be a big thing to challenge. And that's also one reason why we want these interconnections, those both to balance demands and supply side. So if as you are most in time constraint, what's your thoughts on this?
I think that the first steps is to really to change the way we think about the energy infrastructure, in a sense to really first look at how you decentralize the maximum, so that indeed you get only to the grid when you really need it at the end. There is really great potential. Their old scenario says it is possible at the end to really have a completely neutral economy if we wish to. So I would first reverse the way we think energy infrastructure. So,
okay, don't know. Thank you. Certain companies are moving into services, meaning energy service, helping households, companies, industries to discuss this, and also in this way taking command of the balancing problem. What's your discussions in SWE?
Well, we represent the wires companies, and I think the question was asked in the previous presentation as to whether the electricity market is European or is local. And I think the answer is it has to be both. What we need to do is send the price signals through the market. whereby clever people on the demand side and on the generation side come up with ways of doing things better. That might be energy storage on the generation side. It might be developing ways of pooling together numbers of households and providing that power to the grid when it's needed, because the balancing challenge is large and is going to get larger. So I think things like that are to be encouraged, and I think the market is the best way of encouraging it.
Yeah, I'll try to answer to you, to your question, Mrs. Valian. But gas storage, it's in Europe, it's very much depending on the country, because the gas infrastructure is a result of gas history and its development, and is a result of the use of gas, is a result of the consideration of security of supplies, which were different from countries. So the storages today are used for security of supplies. They are used for seasonal use, because in most of countries you've got more consumption in winter than in summer. In other countries they are used for daily flexibility. And at some other places, storages are 100% market parts, so you can inject or withdraw gas when the market wants, without any consideration of seasonality, for example. So storages are tools which are used in different ways. If you consider flexibility, you've got other sources of flexibility which can exist. There are LNG terminals, for example. You can imagine flexibility sources on the consumer side, for example. But if I go back to storage, what Ensoji saw when they run their simulation on security on supply and on the 10-year development plan, they saw that there was a kind of lack of storage withdrawal capacity in case of disruption scenarios in winter. For example, if there is no gas from Russia, it can be difficult to sustain a long crisis. So we could say there is a need for new storage development, but for security of supply consideration and for market consideration too. And there is a very important difference between storage and transmission, that is that transmission infrastructure are regulated infrastructure, and storage infrastructure, it depends from the country. In some countries, it's regulated. In other countries, it's a negotiated access. And with different kinds of developments. But I think there is, we can say there is a need for development for storages. But one difficulty for storage, specific difficulty for underground gas storage, is that the development of the facilities is very, very long. For gas pipe and LNG terminals have got a very long development, because you need 5 to 6 years between the decision and between the start of the project and the start of the gas flow in the pipe. If you look at storages, it's 10 or 15 years, depending on the countries, because it's very, 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 it's very long. So it is even more difficult to take the final investment decision for storages. And these decisions are today depending a lot to what the market wants to do with storages.
Thank you.
And just one word, if I may. And when we talk about security of supply and all these kinds, there's one important point. We need infrastructure, but first of all, we need that someone brings the gas into the system.
Yeah, you need the source.
Yes.
Okay. I was almost tempted to say, may the source be with you, but I will not. Having seen all these films with my kids. I think storage, in a way, storage and balancing is part of the same problem. I think it's very interesting the way there is new cabling between Denmark and Norway, and Denmark and Sweden and Norway, with hydro, with gas, and with wind in the respective countries, where the country agree to balance each other's need. And Norway using the gas, but transforming it into electricity, because the cabling and the decision-making process is so much easier for electricity, especially if it's hidden in the water or in the ground, than big gas pipelines. So there is, I think there's a new way of thinking around this that is extremely interesting, and that will still keep the gas in the mixture, but maybe transforming into electricity the last phase because of the decision-making process, simply. Adina-Ioana is the rapporteur and the organizer. Do you have a last comment before I close the meeting?
Thank you very much for your presentation. Also, I was right now thinking, we have this topic of connecting Europe's transport and energy infrastructures. And there we have 27 markets in Europe. And we are debating on connecting the infrastructures, but still there is a need to invest in each of any those infrastructures. So there are two topics, one on top of the other. So, and well, in the end, we'll try to do our best when we discuss your energy infrastructure to provide for the consumers and the citizens and also for the industry. Thank you very much.
And it might be that it's easier to find, for the investors to turn to infrastructures like this as a safer investment than maybe a lot of other financial markets we find today, and try to solve also the problems within the Parliament. I would like to thank you very much for your contributions. It's been highly valued, and I noticed that there is a lot of members' offices, and that means that there's a lot of legislative attention and attraction to this seminar, which is, of course, very good, and I do hope you found it fruitful to participate in this debate, and we will continue this now after we met like this, because there will be a number of dossiers coming on in the future that affects the market and the infrastructure and the investments. So thank you to the panel, thank you to the participants, and thank you to the staff for organizing.